Welcome to the PG.biz podcast. I do not have Brian Bagla with me at this moment, but he is coming back for future episodes, of course. For now, here I am, your host, co-host, Peggy Ann Saltz. We welcome Claudia Trujillo. She is ASO expert at Gameloft. And you may have seen her, and you might have seen her, because if you're looking at our events, she is a frequent speaker there, but she's out there everywhere. And now on our podcast as well. So if you've been watching past episodes, and you should, you'll notice that I called out Piyush Mishra as my go-to for all things data in a post-privacy world. Well, I'm going to call out Claudia as an ASO wizard, a kind of a data diva, but you wouldn't know it to read her bio, because her bio is an understatement. In 2010 is what she writes. She ventured into marketing and then started to work with paid campaigns and then went on to playing with SEO and ASO algorithms. That's all we know about her. But I think the wordplay speaks volumes, because that's what she does. She has fun with ASO, and it's going to be fun to learn from you today. So welcome, Claudia. Great to have you.
Thank you so much. Thank you for having me.
I'll pick up with the whole idea of the wordplay. That got me, because I was thinking, oh, playing with algorithms, because that's what you do and you do it extremely well. But perhaps it tells us that maybe app marketers are trying too hard to win in ASO. They're not playing. They're not tapping into the creativity to see around the corners, see the opportunities, think outside the box. What do you think?
I kind of agree. It also depends on the people that we're talking about. But I think that what you should be doing with algorithms overall is just testing the waters, have fun, have different hypotheses and test them, because that's the way that you're going to be seeing what are the results.
Great segue for our show, because it's about results, but looking at the misconceptions about the results. And we're going to do a little bit of myth busting, because if we go too deep down into the weeds, which is where you can go, of course, Claudia, then that's a whole different type of podcast. And actually, people should just contact you directly. So we're going to keep it at the level of UA and ASO. There are ways that they connect, complement each other. There are ways that they cannibalize each other as well. So starting off with the whole idea of the creative itself, that UA should only show UA text strings, UA creatives, what UA does is the only thing that they should be displaying. What do you say to that?
I would say to that that that's a myth. UA can be done in different networks. You can have ads in different placements, and that it's the virtue, I would say, of UA, that there is also some part of their ads that is coming from the listing that we're working towards from the ASO standpoint. So some written assets, some visual assets that we are adding on those store listings are also seen in the UA ads. So it's also to take into consideration when you're going to be analyzing the performance of those ads or even the spending. It is only because of the strings of texts and visual assets that that ad is having, or also because of the noise that ASO is adding to it.
But why do you think that there is that misconception in the first place?
I think that the misconception comes from the point of we're paying the ad, we're having the full control over the ad, but that's not the case.
Well, I've got a list of myths I've put together from other talks that you've done, so I'm going to continue with these. Another one is that UA does not impact organic traffic. That sounds like a big one.
Yeah, exactly. That it's also kind of on the same lines as I mentioned before. There is a misconception of I'm paying the ad, I'm only going to be reported under traffic sources that are about paid traffic. But that's not the truth. The truth is that paid sometimes is also part of the data results that you're having on organic traffic sources. And it's also impacting organic traffic, because at the end of the day, what the paid ad is having as a result is having more downloads. So it is telling the algorithm of the store, hey, more people are downloading my game. But the algorithm, it's also trying to understand if it's a trend. So it would also boost the visibility, the organic visibility in the store, because it's seeing that people that are coming from paid are liking your game and downloading it. So it feels like organically, your game should also be doing well.
Could you maybe elaborate a little bit on how hunches can fool marketers?
Yes, absolutely. So it is the fact that once you're doing marketing, sometimes the teams are really split or doesn't share that much learnings or communication of their strategies between paid and organic. So the fact that you can be talking together or even the same team can be taking care of both organic and paid is where they are going to find out if what you're doing for the paid ads is also impacting the organic traffic and trying to understand better the graphics that you're going to be seeing on the consoles or any analytic tool that you're using, and vice versa. Organically, you can also reach out to the paid team to see how their performance or what countries they are, for example, targeting might be also affecting your data gathering.
Before I move on with the myths, I also want to better understand, is this for specific game genres? Is this really more about casual mostly, or can I adapt your learnings, what you're sharing with me, what the real practical advice is? Can I adapt that to other genres?
That's a great question, Peggy. It can be adapted to any genre of game, and it can be adapted also even for apps and to other platforms that are not precisely mobile industry.
That is probably the best news at all here, Claudia, because it tells us that we can apply this to basically all app marketing out there. And continuing with app marketing, another myth, ASO, A-B tests do not impact UA ads. That's an interesting myth. Tell me about that one.
Yes, exactly. As I was mentioning before, on the paid ads, there are assets that are seen from the ASO listing, some from the asset from the stores that we're creating from an ASO standpoint. So those icons that you might be testing can also be showing different icons on your UA ad, can also be showing different videos that are fetched from the store listing that we're creating from an ASO standpoint on the UA ad. If you're changing some of the text strings from an organic standpoint, those can also be seen on the UA ad. So the fact that you can be having ads while there is an A-B test ongoing for ASO store listing, that can also impact different segments of the audience, different percentages of the public that are going to be seeing your ad with different visual assets that, as I said before, are not fully being controlled by the UA team that is handling those ads.
It's like being stuck between a rock and a hard place, isn't it? Because how do you do that? You have to test. At the same time, you don't want to impact because you don't want too many variables, because you'll never know what it was that moved the needle or the opposite. What's your thoughts? What's your advice there? Because that's a tough one.
It is. It is, in fact. What I would recommend is that when you're going to be launching an A-B test, you talk with the team that is managing your ads and tell them which are the visual assets or written assets that you're going to be testing. Show them the iterations. Tell them in which country or language you're going to be having these ads, so they can also understand if there is a change on the performance of those ads, that it's not because something regarding the algorithm of those paid platforms, but it's because it might be impacting of ASO tests that we're running. And on the other side, I would also, in a way, take over this advantage that UA can be having through the A-B test and tell the people that having UA, as I mentioned before, you're having more downloads and more reaching to more users in a short period of time can also be good for your A-B test, because you're going to be having a shorter period of time, the data gathering for that A-B test. So that can also improve your process of data gathering and plan the next steps for the roadmap testing.
Running down through the list, here's one. And this came from a recent talk that you did, Games Forum. It was actually ASO categories cannot impact UA visibility. Surprise.
It impacts UA visibility. There are specific networks that people would be bidding for. And in that case, it really depends on the category of your game, but also of your app. As I was mentioning before, this can be applicable for both games and apps. So depending on which category your game is at, in this case, you're going to be bidding against other games that are on the same category. It means that if you're in a category that there is a ton more other competitors that also want to bid in that network, your chances might be lower than if, for example, you change your category. And this can also be an analysis that you can conduct on the Google Play category peers analysis to see how you would be doing on a different category compared to your peers. And that way you can also see, okay, with my current performance, with my current numbers of data, how I would be doing if I would change my game from arcade to simulation or from arcade to adventure. So it always needs to be a category that defines your game, but doesn't always have to be a category that is just super strict and that you are maybe performing low or maybe your costs are too high for UA. So you can branch out your analysis and try to catch up on these myths and try to adapt your strategy against what your previous thoughts were about it.
An ASO, we know, it's never set it and forget it. How often should games marketers be tweaking this, fine-tuning this? Any thought about how to get really the most mileage out of your choices?
It really depends on the average amount of visitors and downloads your game is having. If you're having a really strong audience on your game, you might have the privilege of being able to test stuff every week, every 2 weeks, every 3 weeks, for example, for icon and visual assets, and then put in those live and see how the full audience would be reacting to that. If your game is not at the top of the visitors and downloads for a category, for example, you might need to trigger other strategies like promotional content, in-app events, trying to pitch your game for featuring on the store and try some other synergies with UA through custom store listings and custom product pages. And then through those, I would recommend you to try to come up with ideas of what is performing best and then A/B test that. Because for those games that are not having that much audience, an A/B test can be running for a month or 2 months in order to have a substantial good amount of audience to take a decision upon. So you better refine what your content is going to be really curated before you A/B test those visuals.
Another myth here, big one, probably very, very important where we are right now, because we want to figure out, games marketers need to figure out, how can they be effective? So ASO conversion rate cannot impact UA costs.
It is another myth, and it's also important for everyone to understand that everything is interconnected, even to the little details, as in this case, the conversion rate. So you can be having a low conversion rate, and it is going to make your game cost for UA ads be increased, because the algorithm of the store is going to be telling the algorithm of the UA network, hey, this game is not relevant, it's not popular. So you better be having another game that is going to be shown in your ads, even if the other game is bidding less than you, but the other game is going to be offering the user a better user experience. So that is why the algorithm is going to be benefiting that other game better. And that is why I emphasize on the importance of the peers analysis on Google Play Console, for example, or even now that iOS also provides this information to see in which other category you might be doing best.
That's it. You have to still focus your efforts, focus your resources, focus your budget. So you do want to have a high ASO conversion rate because you want to keep UA costs in check, but there's still a balance there. There's a trade-off. Do you have any advice about making that trade-off? Because it'd be great if we just all had you, an army of you, and then indie developers in particular could be adjusting this to get the best benefit, but that's not the case.
Exactly. In that case, I would recommend to focus on which are the regions that are gathering for you higher level of monetization. Maybe there is top 5 countries, top 10 countries. Maybe if your game is not about monetizing, it's just about downloads. So also focus on those top 5, top 10 countries. And in those countries, focus to have the organic conversion rate really high, at least compared to the peers of the category that you're in. And therefore, when you're going to be running UA ads for those regions, you can also enhance the UA performance based on how well the conversion rate for those specific countries is going to be having already.
What does that also demand from, say, for example, an indie studio in understanding how to put together the teams and the talent to do this? Because what you're talking about is it's creative, it's data analytics, it's strategy. You sort of also want to have the CFO or the equivalent in there as well to watch the budgets. What does this look like in real life? What does this team look like? Or what does this effort look like?
I don't think it really always needs to look like a team. It can be just one person. For example, I know that my agency peers here would be aligned with what I'm going to say, but if you are focused on one client, for example, or if you have several clients, you will be already knowing which are the countries that are the most important one for the client, monetization-wise or download-wise. And so for that ones, you should be focusing on whether to run, for example, A/B tests, whether to improve your ASO strategy, whether to have a higher ASO strategy overall through the different elements that can be done. So written assets, visual assets, live ops, what are you going to be promoting on the stores? What are you going to be enhancing for the onboarding of the users of those countries? And therefore, when you're going to be running UA ads, you will already know which is attracting the most users from those regions, what is working best organically. So you just need to deepen your thought for the paid users by testing those visual assets, similar assets for the UA ads, and also targeting the same countries that you are already knowing really well organically. And it can be done also vice versa. Once you know how the users from those specific countries that you want to target for UA are, how they are behaving with your ads, how they are behaving with your game, what they are doing internally, you can also apply those learnings to the ASO organic listing. So it can be one person that is just focusing really well on the analysis for those regions and then applying some synergies between UA and ASO. Or it can be a team that it's someone focused more on the organic analysis and someone else focused on the UA analysis and someone in between that it's also managing the monetization analysis and coming all together to improve the performance.
So before I move on to another myth, what you're saying here is also it's very important that the members of the team also have access to the data that they need to make these decisions.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Without data, these decisions would not be able to be made properly. So you need to have the full picture of how your game is going.
It's probably a little bit of alchemy in figuring out exactly this structure within your company, maybe even at Gameloft, a little bit of trial and error to figure out exactly what does this process even look like. I mean, great, I hear people say, yes, we all get together, we have a brainstorming session, we share the data, hopefully not in a spreadsheet, but could you just, before I move on, our audience would like to put this into practice. Are there some thoughts, some advice you could give about exactly that, making certain everyone has what they need to make these really critical business decisions?
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. I would say that the easiest way would be to have some dashboards where you are sharing both organic, paid, and monetization information. So you can all go to one place, and maybe there is not always a need to have a meeting. Someone can be on holiday, someone can be on sick leave, but if you need to take a decision, you already have all the data in one place. So you can see what has been going up, what has been going down, which are the results that are going well, and which are the ones that are not meeting your standards. So if you have everything on one place, you can take better decisions and plan better your strategy.
And ultimately impact performance, which is the last myth that we're looking at. ASO average rating, ASO average rating cannot impact UA performance. No, 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 it cannot. That's a myth. Tell us why.
It's another myth, indeed, Peggy. The general knowledge is that, as I was already referring before, visual assets or written assets from ASO are not affecting UA. Category from ASO is not affecting UA. And the conversion rate from organic is not affecting UA. But it is, and it's the same way as for average rating. my fellow peers that are focused on ASO would know about the thresholds for average rating 4.1 to make always your game really appealing for the editorial team of the stores to gather featurings. So it also translates into the same meaning for the UA platforms. They also want to showcase those games that are mostly valued, that are having a great user experience for the, at the end, the clients that are seeing those ads, so those users that would be downloading the game. So if your average rating is below the threshold that the stores always have 4 stars, and this is something that it's globally known for both mobile, computer, and console, your ads are going to be more expensive because you will need to bid higher for a placement that someone with a better average rating would be already obtaining with bidding less. So it's always important to at least be at 4.1 stars to make sure that you have the visibility that you owe or that you're bidding for.
What I find interesting personally, Claudia, is how you know this so extremely well. You know, translate it in such a way that it has practical implications. But we also want to be honest. And life is full of mistakes. I'm sure you've made a couple of your own. Share with us a personal mistake that shows us, yes, there is a learning curve and there's nothing to be ashamed of here, but something that you've done where, you know what? It was a good mistake because you did something better as a result.
Absolutely. For example, I would always take the learnings from my B-test and just do little iterations after little iterations to make sure I know what is the element that is making the user want to download more of the game. So for specific games, we would do these little iterations one at a time, and no new iteration for over a year, I would say, could beat up the what would be the default icon, the default featuring screen, because this happened for different assets. So we took the decision one day of, okay, let's go with more daring visual assets. Let's just skip all these theoretical that it's supposed to be about A-B tests and just create new assets from scratch, all about what the game is about, but non-visual asset was related to the other one. Like, you wouldn't tell exactly why one was winning versus the other. And we run these new assets, and after 2 years of keep on testing things, starting from the little iterations to these bigger ones that were not having anything in common, we finally beat the current, what was the current visual asset at the time. We did the same strategy of, okay, totally daring new visual assets for screenshots, for video, for feature graphic. And that's how we got to a full new store listing that doesn't have to have anything related to the original one, doesn't have to follow the ABC of ASO or A-B testing. But as you said, all these mistakes that we did turns out to have a better learning, which is not always kind of following the rules is going to take us into the right position to improve the performance of the game. And from there, we have also applied this mentality to other games to, okay, we're not having any relevant result from A-B testing. Let's just do some new visuals completely from scratch and let's just test it. And this is how we have kind of broke the mold of, okay, we're just having all these new assets that we're not doing anything, just wasting the time of the creative studio team. So let's try something more daring. And this is how we, in a way, broke the algorithm and turned out to the other side of having new visual assets, new writing assets on several games that were not having any effect before.
And nothing wasted because...
Exactly.
It started something. It started you off in a different direction. Now, what's going to be really exciting is when we get to a point, maybe someday, when generative AI can come up with something completely different, because right now it just puts together everything we have. So with that in mind, what does generative AI deliver at this process in this point? Are you experimenting with it, playing with it? Does it bring value here?
I would say it brings value, especially when we're trying to come up with ideas. For example, as you said before, in a brainstorming meeting with different teams. And we're not designers. We don't know how to tackle those programs. We have the ideas in mind. We don't know how to literally portray them, to show them to the other peers of the meeting, and then to kind of provide our vision to the creative team. So we would go to some AI tools and try to see if by feeding it with information and ideas from our side, we can come up with as close as we can to what we have in mind, to then present it to the others. So then the creative team can adapt what we have in mind to characters that are from the game, but that visually look like what AI can be sharing with us. So that's one way that we can take advantage of that, to brainstorm ideas, or even if we just have ideas of characters that we would like to have, we can just feed the AI and see what they would come up with. And same thing with written assets. You can also test with AI some information about your game. You can feed AI with some specific keywords and see what they would come up with, which is sometimes more creative than what someone in the marketing industry can come up with, because sometimes we are really closed-minded on the sense of we need to follow these rules, we need to follow this sort of written purpose, and sometimes we are too cohibit of what we would like to say. And then AI comes up with really good ideas of what we could be adding to the table.
I was just thinking what one marketer told me, how she was using it, which was checking the conversation, sort of like the social conversation about her game, and however it was being described, getting a little bit of inspiration for some keywords, and as well as creatives, but mostly keywords there. Is that something that you would say is a good practice? Have you tried it yourself?
I would say it's a really great practice. Something similar is what I do, what we usually do, is that we go to different tools that would scan the reviews and would give us the cloud of keywords that are repeated the most, depending on the sentiment, and would also take ideas for the keyword strategy based on what the reviews are saying on that sense. But I think that her idea is also really good, really well thought.
So what we hear through this is that ASO is a blend of art and science as well.
It is, absolutely. And as much data you can add to this equation of science, the best it's going to be. And the funner, because as I said at the beginning, you need to play with it. You need to see how it reacts, how it responds.
And that's what I like. You have a playful attitude toward this as well. I said at the top, your go-to person, you're my go-to person for all things related to this. Where will we be hearing from you, seeing you in the coming weeks and months, Claudia?
Sure. So in a couple of weeks, I will be attending ASO conference in Berlin.
We'll see each other there. Cool.
Yes.
I'm happy. Now.
Absolutely. Okay. Awesome. And at the beginning of June, I will be at Growboat with the peers of Admiral Media. So I would also hope to see all of you there.
Awesome. And on a boat, what could be cooler? Seriously.
Exactly. On a boat in Barcelona.
For him, but he's got a great concept and a great idea and the best month for it. Well, it has been a delight and hope to have you back again soon. Thanks again for being on our podcast today.
Likewise. Thank you so much for having me, Peggy.
This show is all about how to do your job better, how to make an amazing game, how to market it. And you have a say. So if you have a story or know someone we need to shine a light on, then we would love to hear from you.
We want to hear from you. We want to reflect the reality of the mobile games market in all its wonderful complexity and strangeness. So if you have any suggestions for us, if you have any feedback for us, you can always get in touch. You can email us at podcast@pocketgamer.biz. You can find us on Twitter at PGBiz, and you can reach out to us through the pocketgamer.biz website. If you're interested in listening to all of our podcasts, you can find them at pocketgamer.biz/podcast, and we would love to hear your thoughts on future shows.
And we've got you covered on all the major platforms, so subscribe to the audio podcast, as Brian said. Look for us on YouTube. If you want to read it, hey, you can do that too, because we have a companion post for you as well on the pocketgamer.biz website.
Tune in again for the next edition of the pocketgamer.biz podcast, and we look forward to speaking to you in the near future. Until then, I'm Brian Baglow.
I'm Peggy Ann Saltz, and that's a wrap until next week.